Welcome to the course on game theory in the autumn term 2020 at the University Mannheim. This is the third video of week 11. So now we come to a family of examples. Here we will study simultaneously all essential cooperative three-person games. Lemma 6.12c. We had seen that the strategic equivalence class of an essential game contains a unique game in 0-1 reduced form. Therefore, it is sufficient to study all the three-person games which are in 0-1 reduced form. And here you see them all together. The coalition values of the one-person coalitions are all 0. The coalition value of the three-person coalition, the total coalition, is 1. Only the coalition values of the two-person coalitions are variables, so they are denoted by alpha 3, alpha 2, and alpha 1 for the coalitions 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 3. So the index of alpha j is chosen such that together with the indices of the two players, it gives this full set 1, 2, 3. So here, such a game is determined by three real numbers, and now we can analyze which conditions on the numbers are necessary and sufficient for the game to be super additive or convex or have a non-empty core. And that we will do now. Claim one. Such a game is super additive if and only if the three numbers are between 0 and 1, including 0 and including 1. Why that? Here I have written the proof of this equivalence, only the implication from left to right, for the case of the number alpha 1, so the value of the coalition 2, 3. So, superadditivity, that was a condition which expresses synergy. That means for any two disjoint coalitions, the sum of the coalition values of these coalitions should be less or equal than the coalition value of the union of these two sets. So that's my slogan for this condition is a synergy effect. So now we can test this. So the value of coalition 1 is 0, the value of coalition 2, 3 is alpha 1, and that should be less or equal than the value of the union of them, which is 1, 2, 3 and has value 1. This tells us that 0 plus alpha 1 is less or equal than to 1. So alpha 1 is less or equal 1. And we can consider the coalition with only of player 2 and the coalition only of player 3. The sum of the values is 0 plus 0, which is 0. And this should be less or equal than the value of the coalition 2, 3, whose value is alpha 1. So this tells us alpha 1 is bigger or equal to 0. So alpha 1 is in this unit interval from 0 to 1. Yeah, and it's quite obvious that we also can go backwards. If alpha 1 is in this unit interval, then we have these inequalities for the two coalitions 1, 2, 3 and 2, 3, which you see. And for the other numbers, we get also some inequalities for certain pairs of coalitions, of disjoint coalitions, and that gives all together the six inequalities for alpha 1, alpha 2 and alpha 3. So I have written down only a part of the proof, but it's quite clear that one can go also backwards and treat also alpha 2 and alpha 3 in the same way. So this is a clear condition for superadditivity. The next claim now, convexity. I claim that game is convex if and only if we have the inequality from superadditivity. That's clear because convex is a stronger condition. And additionally, we have the three inequalities in the second line. Alpha 1 plus alpha 2 is less or equal 1, alpha 1 plus alpha 3 is less or equal 1, alpha 2 plus alpha 3 is less or equal 1. So I want now to show why in the convex case these inequalities in the second row hold, and I do this now for the inequality alpha 1 plus alpha 2 less or equal 1. So in the convex case, one considers also pairs of coalitions B and C which are not disjoint, and then one demands that the sum of the coalition values of coalition B and of coalition C is less or equal than the sum of the coalition value of their union plus the sum of the plus the collision value of their intersection. And here we test this with the collision 2-3 and the collision 1-3, which intersect in the player 3. So in the collision values for these two collisions are alpha 1 and alpha 2. And then the union is the total collision with value 1, and the intersection is then the collision of only one player, which has value 0. So this tells us that alpha 1 plus alpha 2 is less or equal 1 plus 0. So it's less or equal 1. So in the same holds for by symmetry for alpha 1 plus alpha 3 and for alpha 2 plus alpha 3. Okay, and now one can also see that one can go backwards. These inequalities are sufficient. So the inequalities in the first line come from superadditivity and they imply superadditivity. We saw that in claim 1. So and the additional inequalities in the second row, they imply also the inequalities for these not disjoint collisions. And here, yeah, the special case where one of B and C is the empty collision or is a full collision that is not interesting, then we don't get a non-trivial inequality. So these three inequalities in the second line, alpha 1 plus alpha 2 less equal 1 and the other two, they give us the missing inequalities which are held in the convex case additionally to the super additive case. So next claim, I claim that the game has a non-empty core if and only if these three values alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 are less or equal 1 and their sum is less or equal 2. So here you remark that we don't need that they are bigger or equal to 0. That's not necessary here for this non-empty core. So now I want to prove this. So I start with non-empty core, and I suppose that I have a imputation in the core, Z1, Z2, Z3. So the condition was that for any collision B, the sum of the values Zi is bigger or equal to the value V of B. And for the imputation, we need that the sum of all Zi is equal to the value of the total collision, which is 1. So this is the first line. This comes from the imputation. And this comes also from the imputation because the values of the one-player collisions are all 0. But the inequalities here in the second line, they come now from two-player collisions. The collision 1-2 tells us that Z1 plus Z2 is bigger or equal than the value of this collision, which is alpha 3. And similarly for for the collision 1-3 and the collision 2-3. So we get here what we want. So now we can rewrite these inequalities. Because the sum of Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3 is equal to 1, this tells us that Z1 plus Z2 is equal to 1 minus Z3. And therefore this inequality Z1 plus Z2 less bigger or equal alpha 3, that is equivalent to 1 minus Z3 bigger or equal to alpha 3. And so now in the next line, we get the same equality Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3 equal 1. And we get now these transformed inequalities. The alpha I is less or equal to 1 minus Zi. So especially then it's also less or equal to 1. So, and from this line here, now we can get to this part here. So the inequality here tells us that alpha I is less or equal 1, which is the first line. And now if I add these three inequalities, then I have alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3 is less or equal to 1 minus that 1 plus 1 minus that 2 plus 1 minus that 3, which is then equal to 3 minus the sum of them. But that was 1, so this is equal to 3 minus 1, and that is equal to 2. I'm sorry for my handwriting, but this is too smooth for me. So by adding these three inequalities, we get exactly the inequality here in the second line. So we get this, the right-hand side of this equivalence here. I want to erase this, it's not so nicely written. So, but we have to go back to, now we start with the right-hand side of this equivalence. So the right-hand side tells us here that these alpha I are less or equal to 1, that means 1 minus alpha I is less bigger or equal to 0. And the other condition tells that here that the sum of the three values is less or equal to 2, and that I can write in this way, 3 minus the sum is then bigger or equal to 1. So, but now, so we have here these three numbers, 1 minus alpha I, each of them is non-negative, and the sum of them is bigger or equal to 1. And that implies that I can choose some non-negative real numbers, epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon 3, such that still 1 minus alpha I minus epsilon I is non-negative, but such that the sum is now diminished and has the value exactly equal to 1. For example, I could start with the first difference, 1 minus alpha 1, and choose epsilon 1 as large as possible, so that this is epsilon 1 might be equal to 1 minus alpha 1, if this is allowed, if the sum of the three values is still bigger than 1. If this would decrease the sum of the three values too much, then I have to choose a smaller epsilon I, but then I'm already finished, because then after the good choice of epsilon I, the sum of the three values will be equal to 1. So it's quite clear that we can choose these epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon 3, such that this inequality here holds, and also such that this equality here holds. So now I can define an imputation in Z with the entries Zi equal to 1 minus alpha I minus epsilon I. And then it turns out that this vector is in the core. So the Zi are still non-negative, and the sum of them is equal to 1. And what else do we need for the core? Yes, and 1 minus Zi must be bigger or equal to alpha I. But that's also true here. That is also this 1 minus Zi is bigger or equal to alpha I because of this epsilon I, which is non-negative. So 1 minus Zi is equal to alpha I plus epsilon I, so that is bigger equal to alpha I. And this one 1 minus, this was the Zj plus Zk if I plus k plus j is equal to 1. So this is the condition for the two-player coalitions. So, and then the core is not empty, and that's what the condition on the left side. So now we have proved equivalence here for the claim 3. So now some more discussion. So star now denotes the condition that a cooperative game is a three-person game and it is in 0-1 reduced form. And with this notation, I can write down some sets and some inclusions or non-inclusions. So I consider always only three-person games in 0-1 reduced form. In the first set, I consider games where the core is not empty, and this is not a subset of the set of games which are super additive, because in the super additive case, all the alpha I must be bigger or equal to zero, and in the case core not empty, this is not necessary. Therefore, this is not a subset. On the other hand, super additive is also not a subset of core not empty, because in the super additive case, I could have the values 1, 1, 1, whereas in the case of non-empty core, the sum of the three values can be 2 at most, it can't be 3. So, and therefore, the conditions core not empty and super additive are not included in one another, and therefore the intersection of these two sets is strictly smaller than both of them. And one part had been written down like this way, and the other part is written here. The intersection is a proper subset of the super additive set. So, and now I can also compare the intersection with the convex set. The set of convex games is a proper subset, because any convex game is super additive. And we know that by theorem 610a that any convex game has non-empty core. But we can see that last part also directly. So the inclusion part here follows from two facts. Any convex game is super additive, and any convex game is non-empty core. And we can also see that the strict inequality, strict inclusion, so there are super edited games which are super additive and have non-empty core, which are not convex. The point is that convexity requires that the sum of any two values, alpha 1, alpha 2, or alpha 1, alpha 3, alpha 2, alpha 3, is less or equal to 1. But in the case of super additive games with a super additive with non-empty core, we can have that the sum of all three of them is equal to 2. But here it's not the case. So let me first explain why convex implies that the core is non-empty. One way is to cite theorem 610a, but we can also use our concrete inequalities for the three-person case here. We have the three inequalities in the convex case, which you see here. And if I add these three inequalities and divide by 2, I get that the sum of all three of them is less or equal to 3/2. And this is strictly smaller than 2. But for the non-empty core, we need only that the sum is less or equal to 2. And for the superadditivity, we need no condition. We have no condition on the sum at all. So therefore, there exist games which are superadditive with non-empty core, which are not convex. So this then gives us this. This gives us that we have a strict inclusion, but it also gives us the inclusion here. So now to summarize, the set of all imputations here consists of the vectors z1, z2, z3 of real numbers such that each entry zi is non-negative and their sum is equal to 1. So this for the conditions of these imputations. So the condition of individual rationality is that I bigger equal 1, and the condition of collective rationality is that I plus z1 plus z2 plus z3 is equal to 1. And now we have the subset, the core. There we have stronger conditions, which we had just seen. For these vectors, we have the same conditions for the one-player collisions, that I bigger equal to 0. We have the same condition for the three-player coalition, z1 plus z2 plus z3 is equal to 1. And we have a condition for the two-player coalitions, namely, for example, z1 plus z2 is bigger or equal to alpha 3. But this can be written as 1 minus z3 And then this is equivalent to the three lesser equal to 1 minus alpha 3. And that's what I had written in this inequality here. So this inequality comes from the two-player coalitions in the definition of a core. So now in the next slide, I show you a picture of the set of imputations, which is here the standard simplex, and within it, different possibilities for the core. So the set of imputations is fixed. It's the standard simplex in these coordinates z1, z2, z3. But the core depends on the three values alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, because of these additional inequalities that I less or equal 1 minus alpha I. And here in the next slide, I show you now this picture. So we have this standard simplex with these homogeneous coordinates z1, z2, z3, such that their sum is equal to 1. And then we have these additional inequalities from the two-player coalitions that I is less or equal to 1 minus alpha I. And in the left big picture, you see some bit generic situation. This upper horizontal line is the condition where Z2 here is. Maybe I take another color. Here where Z2 is less, here then where Z2 is less or equal to 1 downstairs. And here we have the condition where Z3 is equal to 1. Less equal to 1, and here the condition where Z1 is less equal to 1. So, and together we get exactly this part here in the middle. That's then the core in this situation here. So, yeah, but it depends on the values alpha 1, alpha 2, and alpha 3. And here on the right hand side, you see several possibilities where these horizontal lines can lie and what is then the in this intersection of these half spaces intersected with a triangle, which is then exactly the core. So in the first picture here, we have a polytope, two-dimensional polytope with six corners. Here we have only four corners in the second case. In the third case here we have a triangle. Here it's a degenerate, it's just the interval. And here it's more generate, it's just a point, and here it's empty. So there are lots of possibilities. We can have some convex polytope with up to six vertices, but it may also be just a line or just an interval or just a point, so or empty. So but this is a rather clear picture, and it tells what possibilities we have for the core of the game. So now we have discussed simultaneously all these three-person games in 0-1 reduced form. Because of strategic equivalence, this tells us also a lot about all other cooperative three-person games. And now we can return to the game 6-14. So I show you the game again here. The three companies, player one, produce a basic product with value a bigger zero. Player two and player three can improve this to a finite product with value b, respectively c, for a smaller b less or equal c. And then we get this table of coalition values, a for player one, 0, 0 for player two, player three, and the coalition 2, 3, b for the coalition 1, 2, c for the coalition 1, 3, and c also for the coalition 1, 2, 3. So this is in fact, which we will see in a moment, an essential game. And now we want to write down the unique 0-1 reduced game, which is in the strategic equivalence class. So now I go back to the example later here. Here it is. So we had seen in the proof of lemma 12 how to construct this. We have equalities which determine the constants k and c1, c2, c3. So the equality for the constant k was given by 1 is equal to k times this factor here in the big brackets, which is in our case c minus a. So here we have the value c and you have value a 0, 0. So it is c minus a. That means k is equal to 1 over c minus a. And the other coefficients, ci, they were determined by this inequality here. So now k is fixed. It is 1 divided by c minus a. So when we get this quotient minus value of this coefficient I divided by c minus a. In the case of the coefficient 1, it is v of I is a, so we get minus a divided by c minus a. In the case of the player 2 or 3, it is just 0 and 0, so c2 and c3 are 0. So we get these three values here. And now we can use all these coefficients in order to determine the 0, 1 reduced coefficient valuation. The general formula is given here. Now for the coefficients of one player, we get the value 0, 0, 0. For the total coefficient, we get the value 1 by construction. So interesting are these values with two members. So the coefficient 1, 2, the v of b is, in that case, has the value b, and we have to divide it by c minus a, so b divided by c minus a, and we have to add c1 plus c2 plus c3, plus c1 plus c2, which is minus a divided by c minus a, so together we get b minus a divided by c minus a. This gives this value here. Then for the coefficient 1, 3, we have the value c here, v of b is equal to c, divided by c minus a, and we have to subtract the c1 plus c3, which is minus a divided by c minus a. So we get c minus a divided by c minus a, which is equal to 1 here. And for the coefficient 2, 3, we have the v of b is equal to 0, and c2 and c3 are also equal to 0, so we have k times 0 plus 0 plus 0, which is altogether 0, so we get the value 0 here. So in this case, we see, we have here now this game in 0, 1 reduced form. So this tells us also automatically that the original game was essential. And now we can apply the geometry from the last chapter and see how the core of this game looks like, using these values alpha 1, alpha 2, and alpha 3. So the statement is here, but maybe I'll go first to the picture before I go to the statement. So that 2 is less or equal to 1 minus alpha 2, which is here 0. That tells that, we have this inequality here, from this half space here, k subset of this closed half space. Then that 3 is less or equal to 1 minus alpha 3, which is c minus b divided by c minus a. This is somewhere here. And then the last inequality, we do not really need it, but because we know that that 1 plus that 2 plus that 3 is equal to 1, but we have it also here. That 1 is less or equal to 1 minus alpha 1, which is here equal to 1. Alpha 1 was equal to 0, so we are here. So all together, then, we get here this, just this interval, nothing more. So here we are in this degenerate case where the core is not empty, but it has lower dimension. It's just an interval. And that's also what is written here on the slide before. The core consists of the vectors z1, z2, z3, so that z2 is equal to 0, z1 is equal to 1 minus z3, and z3 is in this interval from 0 to c minus b divided by c minus a. So here the core itself is an interval. And the game itself is super additive but not convex. We have now to test our inequalities for these properties, super additive, convex, non-empty core. So the core is non-empty, we know that already. The game is super additive because these three values, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, they are all non-negative and all less or equal 1. So they're all in this close interval from 0 to 1. Therefore, it is super additive. But it is not convex because the sum of alpha 2 and alpha 3 is not less or equal to 1. So alpha 3 is positive because b is strictly bigger than a, and alpha 2 is 1. So the sum of them is strictly bigger than 1, and therefore the game cannot be convex. So that's what I also have written here. So this is an application. So we have had considered this concrete situation. We got this cooperative three-person game, and now we see from our general discussion, it is super additive, it is not convex, and we know the core of this game by our general ansatz from the big example 6.16. So this is some kind of success. We know how to treat these three-person games, and we have a small but general theory for the three-person games, which covers all cases. And this finishes now this video. Thank you very much for your attention.